Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again, folks. I'm Bruce Broussard, the Oregon Voters Digest. Happy Easter to all. Happy Easter to all. We may have Reverend Cummings, who will probably give us a little message in regards to recognizing the Holy Ship Easter. And it's a very important time. In fact, just on a little side note, my wife hid 4 eggs for me this morning, and I found 2. but all goes well. It all goes well. But anyway, happy Easter to all of you. And as soon as Matt comes on and we can get him, I think if we have him now at this point in time, he's going to just give us a sort of a little message, you know, from a ministry standpoint. If Matt's there, why don't you just give him and open up the loudspeaker here so we can hear his message to the people at all. Okay? Is Matt there?
Yes. Okay, how Matt. Are you, Bruce?
All right, how you doing, Matt? Well, fine. Yeah, well, what's your message? What would be your message to all these Easter folks out there, especially to the little ones?
Well, first off, just happy Easter and happy resurrection to everyone today.
Mm-hmm.
And that this is to be a day of positive reflection on how we can make our country better, Lord knows. And in regard to the little ones, that as many eggs as possible you can find, that would mean good tidings to you during this time of year.
And a prayer and a blessing of some sort?
Sure. Quick prayer for everyone. Lord, we just ask, we thank you for Bruce and for Oregon Voters Digest, and Lord God, for all that it does to educate. And Father, we ask for divine wisdom, Lord God, during these very challenging times in our country and in the state of Oregon, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Matt. Hope to see you soon.
All right.
And happy
Thanks
Easter
again.
To you,
Bye
too.
Bye.
Thank you very much.
You too.
All right, folks. Well, I tell you what, as one would say, there are many of us within our ranks here, within this state, within this country, for that matter, that are not going to have an Easter. And in all due respect, that's why we're going to have this show today, because we're right in the midst, if you will. We're still in the midst of a recession, and we need solutions to those areas. And so what we're doing now, we're right in the midst of the election aspect of it, and we're going to just get right into the election. Very, very important piece. And we're going to start off this particular show. In fact, we're going to have a 2-hour show, basically called the Oregon Voters Digest Candidates Fair aspect of it. And so we're going to really get into it to kind of find out just who are these individuals that are basically wanting to take us out of this, the leaders, if you will, that are going to respond to the issues that are facing us today. I mean, economic issues, I mean, across the board, you know, crime, the whole nine yards. And more specifically, we talk about the Oregon situation right in this point in time. And so with that, what we were going to do in the first show was going to basically invite the Republican Party chairperson and the Democratic Party chairperson. And as you know, Bob Williams is my co-host. He's a Democrat, and I'm a Republican. And we were going to have a debate between our two chairs. Unfortunately, the Democratic Party did not show up. At least the chair didn't. And so Bob's going to have to maybe see if we might be able to pick this guy up later on down the road. And I'm sure Arthur's going to be ready to go. So the bottom line is that, Bob, good luck. Let's see if we can get Frank over here and see if we can put something together in the very, very near future, because we do have a primary and then we have a general election. But so that's the bottom line. So the Democratic Party is not going to be here. So we're just going to go ahead on with the Republican Party. I've invited a couple of other very serious candidates from the Republican Party side, both the Senate, from the Senate, and also from a congressional standpoint. And we got two very neat people, and they're here with me right now. We've got Joe Ray Perkins. She's running for U.S. Senate. Hi, Joe Ray.
Hello,
how's it going?
Bruce. Excellent.
Hard worker. She knocks on many, many doors. I know. She knocks on mine. She said, Bruce, I'm running. And then we got James Buechel for Congress. I mean, he's a very important piece, especially from a local standpoint, because we have our representative, our congressman, Earl Blumenauer, who's our sitting congressman. And in all due respect, there are issues here in terms of him following up with some of the concerns that we have here within our district. Very, very important piece. And James is very, very articulate. He's a local businessman. He happens to be an attorney, a very responsible one. He identifies with small businesses. and family issues, eviction issues. I mean, he's right in there, and hopefully the voters need to hear him, and that's why we have him here today. So we got two key people here that are representing the Republican Party and some of the issues that we are very familiar with. As you know, we were very, very interested in that whole issue with the bridge issue here in this area. I mean, I mean, I've had some shows that talked about that issue, one of which was the fact that we spent over $200 million on this thing, and the people were very upset about that, the fact that we spent that kind of money, which could have gone to senior citizen issues and veterans issues, all kinds of issues, aspect of it. That's a very important piece. Another issue right up front with you is the whole issue of affordable care, that whole piece. I mean, in Oregon, you know, we have our own Affordable Care Act aspect of it, and it's a problem. I mean, it still is a problem. People still don't know what to do and where to go. And so that's another major, major, major issue, and many other issues. But the fact is, those are the two major issues that in all due respect, our viewers are very familiar with. And so with that, I'm going to get Art to come in on board right now and sort of like give us sort of an overview. He is the state chair of the Republican Party. Give us an overview of what are the other candidates talking about? What are some of the issues that they're talking about around the state? And then bring it on home here. Art?
Well, as you know, many Americans are having difficulties. A lot of difficulties, and many of those originate in government, both government doing things which are not necessarily good for the people, and also failing to do things that the people need. And the Republican Party wants to help. We know we can help. And an indication of that is the kind of candidates we're beginning to get. We have a fine set of candidates throughout the state. These two candidates here today are representative of that. These aren't politicians. Mm-hmm. More and more, we're seeing citizen volunteers.
Say it one more time. They're not politicians.
They're not politicians.
Wait, most times they're always talking about they're politicians.
No, they're not politicians.
Republican parties, you mean, are really being responsible this time around?
Yeah.
no politicians?
No, wow. I didn't say there weren't any politicians.
Oh, okay,
in the party,
okay.
But
right.
There aren't
Let's
any in this
fair.
Room.
Let's be fair.
And
okay.
The point I'm making is that more and more Americans from all walks of life are standing up and saying, I think I can help. Let me help. Mm-hmm. And the Republican Party is where they're going, because Republican principles can help. But you also need people you can trust, people you know care about you, people who will help you to the degree they can. And we have a lot of candidates now in the Republican Party. The Republican Party is attracting people like this. Our opposition is still pretty much career politicians. But the party is attracting the brightest and best from the country who are standing up and saying, we want to help, we want to do something. These two candidates are like that. They're not politicians. We have a lot of them around the state like that. So if you want to, you really should look at these people. They're not going to give you a big resume about all the political offices they've held or all the influential people they have met or all the money they can get from the special interests that already favored.
Right.
Instead, they're ordinary Americans who have stepped forth out of their occupation simply out of compassion. And we have a lot of that in the Republican Party. You mentioned two issues, the bridge issue and the medical care issue. You know, our medical care system is in trouble. Mm-hmm. The costs have gone sky high, partly because of government requirements. But we're not out to blame somebody. We're not out to tear somebody down. We're out there to fix things so that our people are better off. Mm-hmm. And the Republican Party of Oregon is fielding a tremendous set of candidates this election who want to do just that.
Okay. You know, Art, one of the things I think could even help some of the viewers out here, the association with the Tea Party in terms of defining what's the definition of the Tea Party as it relates to Oregon? What's the deal?
Well, I went to a Tea Party meeting when I first became active in politics here a couple of years ago, and I'll tell you the most startling thing about them. I met hundreds of people at that Tea Party meeting. I didn't meet a single person I wouldn't be delighted to have in my home for dinner.
Okay.
they're just wonderful, ordinary, grassroots Americans. Many of them are wandering around knowing, like I mentioned about our candidates, only a few people are running for office, mm-hmm. but the Tea Party is millions of people who are walking out of their houses and saying, what can I do to help? Mm-hmm. And they're going to meetings. Mm-hmm. And they bring with them the conservative values that are the basis of our nation. Mm-hmm. You know, the polls show that 2/3 to 75% of Americans are conservative, mm-hmm. Democrats as well as Republicans. Yeah. And the Tea Party is really a collection of millions of Americans doing the same thing these two candidates have done, walking out of their houses saying, what can I do to help? Can I help? Mm-hmm. What can I do? And they go to big meetings. Mm-hmm. And since they're conservative by nature, since their values are the base values of the American people, mm-hmm. like I said, the best way to characterize a crowd at a tea party mm-hmm. is you won't meet a single person you wouldn't be happy to have in your home for dinner.
You know, a lot of times people don't understand.
That's the way it is.
Tea party folks can be Democrats, too. They all walk
through. Oh, no, wait a minute. Yeah, it's very, very important.
Make sure we understand.
It is extremely important to understand the political party is not that important in this. Mm-hmm. The Republican message and the kind of people the Republicans are attracting as candidates are better for America. But just because you're a Democrat, look, I'm a Republican. My family's been Republican since the party was founded 150 years ago. Mm-hmm. I could just as well be a Democrat and have the same views. Mm-hmm. This isn't a question of deciding whether you're Republican or Democrat and voting one way or the other. It's a question of looking at your values, the values of the candidate, and making a decision. There are elections. We won an election in Josephine County last November. We won it 4-1. We got half the Democrats for a Republican issue. Mm-hmm. It wasn't a Republican issue. It was a Josephine County issue. It was an issue for the people. Mm-hmm. So I don't think people should concern themselves so much with what party they're in. They should concern themselves with whether they trust that candidate, whether that candidate will try to help them, and whether they share similar views. The party system's broken in this country. Just turn on a television set any day. The way to fix a country is to let the grassroots Americans who share our values go up there to Salem, to Washington, to the counties where we're running for county commissioner. Let good, solid grassroots Americans go up to those places and fix them.
Okay.
And it isn't a question of what party they're in.
And I guess the other point I was going to ask you in regards to the whole issue of minorities and women aspect of it, you know, you recruited me.
You know, I think you recruited me.
Well, you recruited me and I recruited you. But the bottom line is that I've always identified myself as a Lincoln Republican. The idea of get back into the history mm-hmm. in terms of the benefits and the contributions by the Republicans during that particular time, mm-hmm. i.e. freeing African-Americans during the Civil War and the whole nine yards. And yet and still, there's this situation out there that says that didn't actually happen from the Republican Party standpoint. Is that part of our history or what?
No, the Republicans were on the right side of those issues.
Okay.
Now it's a long time ago, mm-hmm. and many generations. So the Republicans can brag about the fact that they were right on the right side of the issues during the Civil War, and they were on the right side of the issues in the Civil Rights Movement in the 60s. They were on Martin Luther King's side,
yes.
and the Democrats were on the other side. Mm-hmm. But we must understand those are political, those are historical things. So we can brag that the Republicans were on the right side, but you know, the people that did the right thing in those days are all gone.
So we're still embracing history.
We, of course, still embrace those views, but we are fortunate to have inherited the accomplishments of those people. We aren't those people because they're gone now.
Yes.
But the Republican Party has been on that side. But don't vote Republican for a Republican candidate because we were on the right side in the 60s. Vote for him because the guy is trustworthy. You can trust him. He's a grassroots man who shares your values, and the career politician he's running against is likely to be part of the problem.
And you also made the other point that you made when you recruited me was that it wasn't about minorities and women, it was engagement. What was your mindset?
Yeah, I watched, as an amateur, you know, I watched this thing where one party, they have somebody's going to reach out to the African Americans or reach out to the Spanish-speaking people and so forth. I think that's silly. You and I agreed we'd reach out to Americans.
Yes, right.
Of course, we know the difference. You're an African-American, I'm not.
We're both Americans.
But the fact is, I mean, I'm a scientist. I'm a biochemist.
Yes.
And I'll tell you, the genetic material that decides which color our skin is so tiny and so irrelevant, it doesn't matter. And I don't like racism. I don't like it in any form. I don't even like it in a positive form. And you and I agreed that We weren't going to politic on racism.
Right.
We were going to politic on Americans.
Yes.
There are communities all over Multnomah County, for example. There are all kinds of people here for us to reach out to.
Yes.
And we agreed that we wouldn't say we were reaching out to minorities. We're trying to engage the American people a little more politically, mm-hmm. because right now politics, you know, why should they involve themselves in politics?
Right
now they need to because it's politics is broken,
okay.
and a lot of good people want to fix it. But it doesn't matter what color.
And you've designated this area as ground zero.
Well, I met you, and I realized that I had a dynamite guy who was going to do a lot of good up here. So what am I supposed to do? I just said, I'll come whenever I can help.
That's right.
And that's what I'm doing.
Appreciate that very much. I might add also, too, besides being the engagement chair, it's not just, quote, this area. It's all for the entire state. So my job is to educate my other politios, if you will, folks who are coming into the deal about their history and et cetera, which I've been doing, et cetera.
You're the engagement chair of the whole party,
That's right. The whole state.
Thank you very much.
All right. Well, now let's see if we can hear from these fine candidates here we have here, and we're going to start off naturally with the U.S. Senate, Joe Ray Perkins. I mean, you know, Joe, I'll tell you right from, I know you're a hard worker aspect of it, but you know, we got a sitting guy. You know, I mean, he can raise all kinds of monies and can send out flyers, if you will, at no cost, on government cost aspect of it, letting them know who he is and who am I talking to? Who is the guy? You know.
You mean Mr. Merkley?
Mr. Merkley, okay. Senator Merkley, he's our senator, but the bottom line is that what are you bringing on the table as opposed to what he's bringing to the table that would benefit Oregonians better?
What I bring to the table, Bruce, and thank you for having me on your program today, I appreciate the opportunity, is I'm a Main Street American. I've lived in Oregon since 1975, married my high school sweetheart. We live in Albany. He's a hardworking carpet installer. I've worked in the financial services industry, raised our kids, but we understand really what is going on out there with the majority of Americans. We are this, what I call the salt of the earth. I'm a Main Street American who gets it, who really knows what people are going through. And we see the effects of government regulations, of the federal government reaching into our lives and telling us what we can do, shutting down industries to where it affects everybody in the region. For example, if we reach back into a little over 20 years ago in the forest industry with spotted owls, that cost millions of jobs throughout the state. And beyond the state, because of shutting down an entire industry, it wasn't just the loggers and the timber fallers and their families, it was all the supporting industry that it affected. We still have not recovered from that because there hasn't been an industry in Oregon because of regulations that we've been able to open up and to replace that lost income.
Mm-hmm. What, from this area here within the metropolitan area, what are the major concerns where, for instance, senior citizen issues, veterans issues, homeless issues aspect of it, and two of the major areas that just as recent, if you will, was that of the CRC, Columbia River Crossing aspect of it, and people here really rejected that piece, over $200 million, if you will, over the last 10 years, which in fact, if we had the $200 million 10 years ago, we could have had a new bridge right off the bat, okay? That's something that folks want to know about that in terms of what would you have done had you been involved in this issue here locally?
With knowing the information that has been brought to my attention and the research that I've done, clearly we need a third bridge, primarily for the truckers. The truckers are saying we want a third bridge because it's safer for the truckers. It's less congestion on the I-5 on the Columbia River Crossing bridge. It's less congestion, so it makes it safer. It lets that bridge that's been there for over 100 years last even longer, and let's divert that interstate traffic, primarily from the trucking industry, over where they're closer to their ports, they're closer to their destinations, and build that bridge that solves so many issues that we're facing today and would clearly cost a lot less money. Big concern that I have with this proposal is the bridge is going to be too low. It's not going to be high enough off the river. So now the state is telling businesses upriver, that's okay, we're going to pay you millions of dollars to either shut down or relocate your business. Okay, well, great. So they relocate. What about, again, back to the timber thing, exact same issue. Now we've got all these supporting industries. Mom and pop stores that are reliant upon these businesses located in their ports upriver, shut down, gone. Now we've affected more communities in rural areas. So this bridge affects Portland in a huge way with the traffic patterns and then migrates out from there.
Affordable Care Act. As you know, we have an option here within our region in Oregon. We've got the kids care. I mean, the Oregon Plan Care, whatever it is. But bottom line, we're having some major, major problems with that situation. How would you have handled that situation?
I would have voted no on that situation. When I look at Cover Oregon, it's the marketplace of where you're going to buy. $300 million to build our own marketplace, that doesn't work. Everything is done by paper. And then, so now you're relying on another person to input your information. I have talked to multiples of people. Their information is incorrect. They've got the people's birth dates messed up. The spellings of their names are messed up. Their income is off. It is so archaic. I used to sell health insurance. Mm-hmm. I'm very familiar with those types mm-hmm. of forms. And the more hands you have handling something, the higher the propensity is for mistakes. I'm not in favor of the Affordable Care Act to start off with. I don't think it's the place of government.
Is it in limbo right now at this point in time? Or can folks out there actually apply? I mean, what's the deal?
Yes,
Is it on or off? What's the deal?
They can apply by paper.
By paper?
Through paper,
where,
yes.
Where and who?
Well, they have to find a navigator. They've got to find an insurance agent that is linked up, that is approved if they want the subsidy through the Oregon Health Care Plan. And then they fill out this paperwork, and then the insurance agent will tell them what plan would best for them. And then they're going to fax that into somewhere in Salem, and then somebody's going to sit down and re-input all that information. And eventually, you'll find out if you have insurance or not.
Yeah, but they say, but right now, they've got a new director coming in at this point in time. I mean, is it open house for business, or what?
It's open house for business with paper.
So who do you go to?
You call up your insurance agent, or you can call the phone number. I don't even know what the phone number is.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's confusing.
It's confusing.
So we don't have anything right now.
It's not as clear as it should be. And on the premiums, I happened to look the other day. I want to know what premiums be. Would they be? My daughter is 32 years old, and she doesn't have health insurance. So I looked. And I did her taxes, so I know what her income is. My gosh, for a 32-year-old single person, the children's father, he covers their insurance through his employer. So just for Lisa, her deductible, the lowest premium was, over $300 per month. She can't afford that. And her deductible was $6,200 a year as a 32-year-old.
But see, with all due respect, it's confusing. Then there's a lot of politics. There's a lot of politics. You go on one side of the deal, it says it's the cheapest thing in town. And on the other side, it says, no, it isn't the cheapest thing in town. The folks out here are very laypersons. They just want the coverage.
They want the coverage. So what's ended up happening is...
What do you do? What's your phone number?
541-979-5395.
Call Joe Ray. She'll
call
answer
me.
Phone. Let's go. Let's go to James.
Here.
Okay, let's go to James here. Now, we got another local issue. We got a guy here that's running against Earl Blumenauer. Trust me. I even ran against Earl. And in all due respect, he's a Democrat. He just takes up all the votes. I mean, all he has to do is say, I'm a Democrat, and hey, that's it. But he doesn't deal with any of the issues that are down. He doesn't deal with the crime issue aspect of it. He doesn't deal with senior citizen issues aspect of it. He doesn't deal with vet issues. I still see vets on the corner here in Multnomah County begging for money aspect of it. Nobody's picking these people up and taking them down to the VA and getting a card. I mean, I see seniors that are, in all due respect, I've heard the seniors that I've talked, because I'm running for office too. For Multnomah County District Number 2, seniors eating cat food. It's ridiculous. Housing aspect of it. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. We need jobs here. We got issues with crime, et cetera, et cetera. But he doesn't relate to that kind of it. James, what are you going to do about this? Is this something that you're going to be getting involved in, if in fact you want, once you win?
Well, let me say this. I think that everybody is pissed because they know that somehow the government has turned into this machine whereby a bunch of rich people get up and say that pretend they're going to solve the problem, and then somehow all that happens is they all get richer and the problem doesn't get solved, okay? I would argue that with respect to federal offices, and that's what we're running here for, running for federal offices, okay? We have a problem because some of this stuff was never any of the federal government's business at all.
That's right.
You know, like health care. It was not the federal government's business at all. And if you have two or three or four layers of government all work on healthcare, mm-hmm. they're going to spend all their time coordinating with each other and having commissions and giving themselves $100,000 yep. salaries, and you get these piles of paper and paper mm-hmm. and paper. You know, there's a simple test for people who are worried about healthcare. You look at your government and you say, is what they're doing put more doctors and more nurses on the streets, or are they just moving stuff around and staffing offices with people and paper? And you look at everything they're doing, and not one of the things they're doing is putting more doctors and nurses on the streets and in the hospitals. Everything they're doing is saying, oh no, you can't build a hospital. You've got to have a certificate of need and necessity. And you have to go through a 6-year bureaucratic process with 300 managers to decide if you can buy one more MRI or whatever. We get this vast apparatus pretending to do something about healthcare, and it's not doing anything. It's just getting in the way. I don't know what the right answer is on healthcare. What I know for sure is that it's not the federal government's job.
Right.
And if the federal gets out of the way, maybe Kitzhaber will solve it. Maybe somebody will solve it. You know, they might decide to solve it like they solve it in Cuba. Let's go out and train up a bunch of doctors and put them in urban clinics, and you work for the state for 7 years, and then you get out and you can be in private practice. I mean, who knows what you're going to do? But right now, you can't try anything. It's all illegal. It's all one size fits all. It's all, here's my 1,000-page Obamacare, and we're going to do it this way, and that's the only way it is, and it doesn't work. And we know it doesn't work. And we know that more people have had their insurance canceled because of Obamacare than have gotten the insurance under Obamacare. So it's a horrible mess. And it's a mess because we got into something that was never the federal government's business to begin with.
Well, share this other thought here. You know, the word is out on the street is that, okay, fine, you got the Obamacare aspect of it, it is a mess and whatever, but the Republicans are saying, yeah, we got a plan, but we haven't seen the plan. What does that mean?
The answer is, you got to think about structure here, okay? It's all very nice to have people saying, oh, we got a plan, okay? My plan is to stop, you know, take this big cancerous tumor, okay, that's sucking all the life out of the issue and fueling all these elite task force and meetings, and just cut it off. We're pruning the tree here. Now, you go solve this problem yourself. You go solve this problem with your local hospital. You go solve this problem with your city. You go solve this problem with Salem. Okay, that's all I'm here to talk about, because I'm running for federal government.
Yes.
If I were running for the state government, I might talk more about how to solve it. But if I talk about solving it when I'm in the federal government, I'm already making a mistake by saying what I could do, because what I could do would be inherently stupid, because a one-size-fits-all thing for the whole country is inherently stupid. The plan for Oregon is not the same as the plan for Vermont. Vermont wants to try a single-payer system. I think that'd be stupid and a mistake, but let them try it. Texas wants to do something else. Let them try it. We'll have 50 different people trying things. We'll find out what works. But having a bunch of people 2,000 miles away in D.C. say, oh, I know it works, and here's my plan, and it's going to work, then you know it doesn't work. Then you know that they're just bullshitting you.
Well, we got the Oregon plan. What about that? Is it working? Should we take the Oregon plan over the...
Well, Kitzhaber actually, 10 years ago or 15 years ago, Kitzhaber was getting in fights with the federal government, because Kitzhaber had a plan that's, okay, we got a bunch of people who are uninsured. We used to have like high risk pools. And the answer is, we got this much money at the legislature, and we got a bunch of people who aren't insurable, and that's what we're going to spend. And you can spend it on this, and you can. And then the federal government comes in and says, well, we don't want you to save this person's life with dialysis. We think you need to do sex change operations instead. And here's 5,000 pages of regulations about what you can cover and what you can't cover. And Kitzhaber's sitting there fighting with the federal government. And eventually the whole thing morphed into, you know, Obamacare. But I have confidence that the state government could do a better job than the federal government, and the local governments could do a better job than the state governments. I remember, you know, down in Silverton, the local hospital down in Silverton worked out a pretty good system for helping, you know, the indigent people in the community, because they didn't have to spend, you know, half what they were doing on paperwork and regulations and approvals and getting 6 months approvals and getting approval from the state. People will solve problems and help other people if you will get out of the way. But right now, we've got a federal government that's in the way.
Okay, let's shift real quick. Like, we got to have you back on this deal. And let's shift another way. Let's get down to the bridge thing, this Columbia River crossing aspect of it.
Yeah.
These were federal, that's $200 million, but that was federal dollars through the Department of Transportation, Federal Highway Administration, okay?
Yeah, but a lot of it was extracted at gunpoint from people in Oregon.
Yeah, but at the same time, the person who was holding the gun, if you will, was our congressman who was here locally, aspect of it. What happened? I mean, he was the one that signed off for that $200 million to be spent.
What happened is they tried to force something stupid down the throats of the people, and the people rejected it. I mean, let me put it this way. I'll put it real bluntly. Light rail is stupid, okay? Light rail is a technology of 100 years ago, okay? We've got Google out there now with trucks and cars that can drive themselves. You can imagine transportation systems that consist of little smart vans that go from neighborhood to neighborhood. Google could design a transportation system that would be a tenth the cost of light rail, okay? But instead, we got a bunch of rich people, you know, and they've got some property. And, well, if we put some rail next to my property, it'll make it worth more. And you've got massive massive amounts of corruption, and they're just going to do this because they can make money off of it, mm-hmm. and because they can attach it like this machine, like a toll machine. You know, let's go out and give us, you know, $200 million, $1 billion that's borrowed, and then we'll stick it to the people of Oregon and Washington for the next 20 or 30 years with tolls to pay back this money that we got up front, mm-hmm. you know? And in fact, they've now got their schemes, you know, it's wonderful now. They can get their $200 million up front without producing a bridge. You know, at least in the old days when they stole the money, you know, you'd have some courthouse that had like pure marble gold-plated walls. Yes. We're stupid, but
saw something.
You saw something. You had marble gold-plated walls. Yes, right. What do we have? We got like impact studies in a file drawer somewhere that no one's ever going to read.
Interesting. Well, you know, another thing, I want you to share this with us too, also too, is that one of his staffers picked up $1 million for consulting fees of that $200 million.
Yeah,
what was that all about?
Well, it's all about consulting. You know, it's all about, we have to all talk to each other, and we have to have multiple layers of government involved, and we have to consult with everyone, and then we have all these laws that don't make any sense. You know, I understand some environmental laws. You know, if you're going to be building a bridge, you know, in the middle of, in some virgin territory, you know, crossing some rare something. But we were talking about replacing a bridge. We're talking about rebuilding a project in an urban area, you know, which is already urbanized. You know, mm-hmm. why do we need to study this thing for 20 years mm-hmm. under environmental laws mm-hmm. that are designed for, you know, essentially, you know, running a highway through the wilderness? They're not designed for just replacing a bridge. But, you know, oh, well, we can't touch the environmental laws. No, because there's an army of parasites making their money off the environmental yep. laws. And so they've got to be consulted, and they've got $100,000 a year. And you may have heard some of these stories from Tiffany Balda, the accountant.
Yes, Tiffany, yeah.
They would have these state workers who were, you know, or it was state workers, I think, who were working in the, and then they would resign and then become consultants because then they could charge hundreds of dollars an hour. And it was just like this giant feeding frenzy, you know, because really the beautiful part about this is nobody cares. You know, nobody knows, nobody ever reads these 1,000-page reports. They can write anything in them. They can type love letters to each other and stick it in the file folder. Oh, I spent 40 hours on it, give me my $2,000. And it just goes on and on and on and on. It's the system mm-hmm. that is broken. It's the system that's corrupt. It's a system that now causes us to pay 5 times as much for public transportation projects mm-hmm. as we did 50 years ago. You take something like the Holland Tunnel or the Golden Gate Bridge and you look how much it cost. And then you sort of escalate that up by inflation. That's not the price of things nowadays. Things nowadays cost 4 or 5 times that much because all of the processes are corrupt and stupid.
Well, gee, I mean, you know, I guess it gets me. I'm really getting fun. Now, this guy represents me, too, and he represents you, too. He's been in there how many years?
Since 96, I think.
Well, I'm just trying to understand. Did you call him up? Maybe you could have talked to him, and maybe he might have... That why you're running? I mean, why are you running? Yeah, I don't understand.
Running.
You don't seem so frustrated.
Look, I'm running because this cancer of government has gotten to the point where it's going to kill the host. Okay, we are now moving toward this ancient Rome phase where mm-hmm. you've got these fabulously wealthy people who are manipulating instruments of government. They've twisted the whole economy around now so that if you're a saver, if you're someone who makes jobs by saving money and investing it, we're going to take your savings and we're mm-hmm. going to shrink them. You know, we're going to shrink them 2% a year. We'll just steal all that from the entire country through inflation. And we'll drive down all these interest rates so you can't make any, people
right.
can't make money. And the whole economy is being destroyed mm-hmm. by this collection of rich people milking off the government. You know, the bankers with their $1 billion bailouts, the railroad men who are blocking the pipelines. These major economic decisions are all resulting in some of the greatest misallocations of capital in the history of the world. And we are all much, much poorer for it. And my opponent is part and parcel, just he's an entrenched member.
Your opponent, what was the opponent name?
Earl Blumenauer.
Okay, all right.
He's part and parcel of this entrenched, you know, puppets of special interests, okay? Mm-hmm. These are people who are going to, you know, it doesn't matter if they build a light rail that doesn't make sense. It doesn't matter if they write these reports that no one reads. You know, they write the report and then they give the money. You know, Blumenauer and his pals were down in Tigard the other day because the folks down in Tigard are having a little election. They'd like to vote on whether light rail is expanded. And all of the people who made giant buttloads of money off the CRC then take some of that money and turn around and fight against the people of Tigard because you don't need to vote on light rail. We don't want you to vote on light rail. We just want you to do it so we can collect another great buttload of money.
Wow. Well, tell me this now. You know, we're talking about two. Well, one is a very senior person, the one you're running against, right?
He's a freshman. I want to save him from himself. Yes.
And then Earl, on the other hand, is how many years there?
I think since '96.
What does term limit means to you? I mean, is this something you support?
I absolutely support term limits. I have supported term limits, a maximum between the House and the Senate of 18 years.
18 years.
Maximum. And I personally think 12 is more than enough. That gives you two terms in the Senate, or you could have three terms in the House and one term in the Senate. I think 12 years is plenty of time in Washington, D.C. There's other people who say 18 years beats everything else that's going on out there. The problem is the reelection rate is in the 90%, 92 percentile, roughly, because of name familiarity. But as when we first started talking, people that have been there that many years, they completely lose touch with the rest of us out here and what's going on. And they sit in their ivory towers or their marble offices, and they do. They come up with all these crazy studies that nobody is going to read and nobody understands them.
But Jerry, on that same point, that people out here frustrated with the same point. People come out here, politicians come out and tell us anything. Mm-hmm. Hey, guess what? We're gonna paint the moon blue. Okay, I'm running on painting the moon blue.
All right.
But it's gonna be green by the time I get there.
Can I get a piece of the blue paint?
So the thing is this, why can't they be held in terms of what they say they're going to do?
Well,
that's the problem.
Because people are bigoted against Republicans.
Is that what it is?
I think so. I mean, I think these people go in there and they tell these lies and the people sort of know it. But they, at the same time, they've been subject to these massive training sessions from elementary school on that, the alternative, though, is just so much worse. You know, these Republicans, they're just so unreasonable and they're da-da-da-da-da and they can't get along. And well, the reason you can't get along, you don't want to get along with people who are looting the country. You want to do something about it.
Yeah,
okay?
That's
and
it.
If you do something about it, oh, he's disruptive and he's not behaving in a bipartisan fashion.
Nice.
Yeah. You know, people, on the one hand, they want the situation fixed, but they want the situation fixed maybe without any conflict or without doing any work or without taking any chances. And yeah, you know, sorry, it ain't that easy.
Well, you know, the reason why I have the two of you here on is that the viewers have the opportunity to speak to you personally. I'm representing the people aspect of it. But what they're going to be bombarded with probably by next week or so when they get those ballots, a whole bunch of material. Mm-hmm. I mean, professional writers are going to put that piece together, and they're going to look at this stuff. They don't even know who it is. But the fact of the matter is, vote for me. Look at me. I'm kissing babies. I'm out here doing this. I've just swam the English Channel. Or I've swam the Columbia River aspect of it. Vote for me. But people like yourselves who don't have that kind of money, won't be able to do that. Why is it that we don't have an educated voter out there? So what do you say to these folks out there?
Well, what I say is,
what should they do?
Well, what they should do is they need to ignore the mailers that come in. Okay. Ignore them.
Okay.
Go research the candidates. We all have websites.
But I don't have a website. But
okay.
You have a phone number, right?
But I have a phone number.
What's your phone number?
541-979-5395.
James, what's your number?
227-1011.
Okay, fine. I guess the point
is 503.
Folks, the point I'm making is that that's what I'm talking about. It's a face-to-face kind of a deal. I mean, I'm tired of seeing all this stuff coming in the mail because I'm just going to round-file this stuff anyway, okay? You know, hey, in fact, when I get the pamphlet, some people are saying, I don't even know who to vote for. If Mickey Mouse was on the ballot, they'd vote for it. Thank you very much. You saved my day.
See Mickey Mouse.
Round file the rest of it.
Well, Bruce, let me try a thought out on you here. Okay.
Give me a break.
If you've got somebody who's been in there for many years, whether it's 6 years or 20 years,
right,
and things aren't getting any better,
right,
okay, you know, isn't the definition of insanity to sort of do the same thing over and over again and expect a different result? So, you know, I'd say to the American people, you're insane if you keep voting for the incumbents over and over, or you're going to get the same thing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. One lasting point. Give me a last note.
Okay.
What do you tell the voting person? Why should they vote for Joe Ray Perkins? Right now, real
my
quick.
My promise is that my staff and I will read every bill before I make a decision how to vote on it.
That's a good one.
Okay, now this bill, these bills have got to pass the following. Number one, is the bill constitutional with the original intent of the Constitution and the amendments, not what did the Supreme Court reinterpret it as?
Are these bills going to put money in my pocket or take money out of my pocket?
These bills are going to reduce regulation. because there's only 18 specific jobs of the Congress listed in the Constitution. Number two, is the bill free of external unrelated projects and spending, the bridges to nowhere? And number three, is it socially and fiscally, that means money, responsible? Is it going to cut the debt and cut spending?
Okay, good. Jane, what do you think?
I got a simple promise. You like me, I'll tell you the truth. I'm not anybody's puppet. You might not like the truth, but I'll tell you the truth.
Thank you very much, and I'll
echo that too.
Good. Art, what do you think? What do you think?
They're great.
Is that for the reflection of the Republican Party around the state?
No, you didn't see politicians. You saw a couple of skilled, highly capable, highly intelligent, grassroots Americans.
Okay.
And like he says, the guys that are in there are screwing it up. Let's send some real people to Washington.
Sounds good. Well, hey, Democrats. Your person wasn't here today, so we only have one side of the deal.
Yeah, issue. You know,
hopefully we can get this deed.
You got to get him in.
Well,
here
Bob's going to get him in.
I want to talk to that guy.
I know Bob will get Frank here next time around.
It couldn't be because he's
afraid.
They
need to register to vote too.
They got to vote. You definitely have to vote. And by the way,
registered.
Yeah, I mean, make sure Bob. I'm sure Bob's going to have him here. We're going to have a candidates' fair next week. We're going to have 2 hours. We're going to have 2 hours running, and so please join us. In fact, we're going to even open up the line. This time, we're going to open up the line, and you can call them anything you want to call them, as far as I'm concerned. Okay, we're going to take a short break, and thank you very much. We'll be right back. Thanks, folks.
Welcome to Oregon Voter. You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Youth, welcome back, folks. Look like we're back here. And, you know, we just got through talking, if you will, about the whole issue that we're into at this point in time. We're talking about the election process, and we're talking about leadership, a leadership that will hopefully be responding to some of the issues that we have here within the community. And I've got a group that it's a good prime example, if you will, of what are some of the major concerns we have here. We got families, you know, we got moms and dads, we've got youth people, aspect of it. We're all having our issues, if you will, about raising our family. In most cases, there's a one-person family, then in most cases, that's basically being responsible. Normally a mom with a son or vice versa, even if it's a couple. We have problems here. You know, education problems, you know, just livability problems, this, that, and the other. Well, here's an operation that's here within our midst here in the Multnomah County area that's basically trying to respond to some of the issues that we're faced with today. And I'm talking about youth minds of awareness. We happen to have the executive director here that's sitting here right to my right, Archie Moore. You said he's a boxer, so he needs to have that logo just to do his job. I had the opportunity to meet with their board of directors the other day, and I was very impressed. But boy, what a job. I mean, what a job. I mean, to be able to deal with all the issues and a one-stop deal. In fact, they do have a good sponsor in Becky McCoy Academy with Becky Black. I mean, I was on her board in McCoy Academy for about 6 or 7 years, for that matter. And it's a tough, tough, tough job. And I saw other board members that are, one of which happened to be sitting down here with me right now. One of the people that are working there. It's just a tough job, folks. But I'm just going to sort of give you an opportunity to meet these folks and meet the organization here aspect of it. And I'm very, very impressed about the fact that they it's the input, the output. Too often you see a program that the money goes nowhere and we get nothing. Well, I've got an example of a situation where it is working. And I've got a mother and her son here. And that's kind of neat to have. And he's going to talk a little bit more about that. Right, Archie?
Yes.
Tell them about your program real quick. Right?
Yes.
What is your program?
Well, we're a therapeutic skills training agency, and we basically work with the community. When we have a participant and they have a goal that we have to work on, we involve the family, regardless of what a contract says. We want to work with that family to give them support, resources to make that participant successful.
What do you do?
We do fun stuff, community inclusions. We do skills building around barriers and how to be successful in the community. We might do some budgeting with our older clients. Mm-hmm. It's a wide range. And actually, Nathan Burgess, he's our lead skills trainer. He's not, Tyler's on our board, but he can tell you a little bit about some of the stuff that
we do. Nate, you're part of it. I saw you yesterday. So what do you do? You didn't talk too much that day. But what do you do, Nate?
Well, I am one of the skills trainers over at Young Minds Awareness. I deal with what Archie was saying. There's a lot of aspects, but the job, some of the main focuses are, finding participants housing, maintaining housing. Mm-hmm. That's a big one, because mm-hmm. Some of them do struggle with these things, and we're kind of, we're not looking to hold their hand, but we're trying to advocate for them and help them to get by in life.
When you say housing, are you talking about the entire family, your placement?
We work with families. It depends on, it's kind of a case-by-case situation. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we're working with just a lone person, mm-hmm. But if they are in a relationship or they have kids or, mm-hmm. we're trying to work with everyone. Mm-hmm. That's what we're about.
Okay. Family. Now you got a mother and her son here. I had the opportunity to meet them today.
Yeah.
And I'm very excited here. Mike is very, in fact, he already wants my seat. He wants to be a moderator like me, and I think it's a good idea. Okay, Mike?
Yeah.
Sounds good. So why don't you share with the viewing audience in terms of what were the benefits you got out of this program?
Well, my son, he helps out. Well, Archie and Nathan, they help him with volunteering things in the community. He helped them him find things to do as far as positive things. And, Michael, go explain to.
Mike, what kind of deal?
Just keeping me out of trouble.
Okay.
And staying away from people that are not that are a bad influence in my life and stuff like that. So just kind of keeping me active in a positive way.
Mm-hmm. What kind of activities are you doing now as opposed to what you were doing? What were you doing before you got into this program?
I was just hanging out with my friends, and I get in trouble sometimes.
Like what? What kind of trouble you get into?
Just stay outside too long. And
okay.
Just
not minding mom a little bit like you're supposed to.
Yeah.
Not cleaning up maybe.
Exactly.
Yeah. But you know what, Mike? We've all gone through the same thing. Trust me. But we had this village thing. Remember, it takes a village to raise a child. And then, in all due respect, we are living in an era now that not sometimes the father's not there, or sometimes the mother's not there. It's not just all fathers. It's mom too. We have deadbeats on both sides of the aisle, right? Mm-hmm. Am I right? Mm-hmm. Okay. But now you indirectly you still have a father. Is your father still involved with your life?
Yes, he is.
He's still. Oh, good. So he's still there. So in essence, he's still reaching out. Is that some of the things that you do? in regards to making sure you get the father at least to recognize the son?
Yeah. And
you guys do that?
Yeah, we work across the board. We got a range of things, and that is one thing that we do address.
Okay.
And actually, Mike, I call him Mike, he's actually a pretty good kid, and he ended up, you know, I was here on Ghetto Rise did a show, and we talked about bullying, and that was one of the incidents that he went through. And he was actually a victim and ended up being the perpetrator. And he done everything he was supposed to. He let his mom know, he let the school know. And the school assured mom that everything was gonna be okay, but he was backed into a corner and he had to defend himself. And now the other stuff, you know, then he has to go through all this other stuff because he defended himself. Mm-hmm. And I had another family too, and I wanted to get her here. And she went through the same thing where I went down to the school, actually, and this was a young lady, and she went through the same process as Mikey. She let her mom know, let the school know, the principal assured her and the family that everything was going to be okay, but then the girl had to defend herself. So they're doing what the parents tell them to do, but the school got to have some responsibility too. I won't say the names of the school, but We want to hold the schools accountable for that type of stuff, because bullying is a serious issue, and we want to address them in the future. Since we had these two incidents, we're going to hold the school accountable and make them do some safety plans and take some ownership on what they need to do, and instead of turning a victim into a perpetrator. Mm-hmm. I went to court with them, and this kid was a giant, you know. And this young man defend. I can't say, I'm, you know, what can I say? You know, was he wrong? Was he right? You know, anybody pushed in the corner is going to defend themselves, right?
We took the steps. We talked to the principal. Michael had made statements to the teachers, told him that he reached out to the teacher and said, we need that. I can't take it anymore. He keeps bothering me.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all written down and stated. But when this incident came down, it turned on Michael, like as if he was the one that, and they were both having problems, like all the kids were, but in the end result ended up having Michael have to be the problem.
Mm-hmm.
And so.
You know, what's interesting about this whole piece, I'm glad you brought this piece up about the bullying aspect of it. There was a major component within our school system that at one point in time was there, but then all of a sudden Portland Public School got rid of them. It was custodians. The custodians were always aware of what was going around that campus and whatever, and they jumped right in the middle of it.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, Portland Public School fired them.
Mm-hmm.
They fired them. And in most cases, a lot of them were African Americans. In fact, the Portland Public School was the largest resource, if you will, of African American custodians in the state. A lot of people didn't realize that. And they were struggling trying to, quote, maintain their jobs and retirement and things of that nature. But the so-called problem was that they needed to save costs. They needed more money. And as a result of that, they cut out these folks who were making these kinds of salaries. But the custodians played a major, major, major role. And there was no bullying during that particular time because they were there because they knew their kids, okay?
Exactly.
And so we don't have that anymore today. Mm-hmm. And now you guys are going to have to respond to that, because the teachers can't respond to it to a certain degree. Right. They've got that job just basically being in the classroom trying to educate them. So when they're out there playing, right there, Mike? Mm-hmm. You don't have anybody on the playground out there now? Who's doing it now?
Nobody. I switched schools.
You switched schools?
Mm-hmm.
But what about the school you're going to right now? Are they responding to it? My point is, when you go out there to play, when recess and whatever, is there a supervisor there to help you out to offset any of that bullying?
Yes.
There is some right now. What do they do?
Well, there hasn't really been any cases of bullying in my school right now, but I just know that they, like, watch, like.
Okay. So what school you go to now?
Saban.
You go to Saban. Where were you going before?
Beaumont.
And you were getting a lot of problems over there.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of problems. Wow. So, Mom, you got him out of that situation with these guys' help?
I did. We were kind of pushed out. We were
pushed out?
Pushed out.
What does that mean?
He almost got expelled. He had to go through a program to come back to school. Well, they actually told him he it's better not to go back to that school at all. So it was basically not even an option to go back to that school. And so we had to go through a program, find him a new school. Saban basically, they took him on. They were really helpful as far as a whole other aspect. There was a whole other, like, it was different as far as they were more welcoming.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, Beaumont seemed welcoming at first, but then when you come in and talk to them as a parent, but when the background is like, when he got in trouble and I'm asking for things to do at home for homework, because whether you're not in school, you still have to have education.
Right.
Didn't get any of that. Didn't get no homework. Didn't get how you doing. Didn't get did he need anything. I was told that you would get stuff sent home, nothing. So we had to have advocate kids, like his mentor went to go find out where's the homework at, where's the schoolwork at, and then had to take like 2-3 times to get something.
Hmm.
He would probably not even pass school. And the excuse was, well, even though he didn't have homework or anything, he at the level in his education that he still would graduate, was good, would finish. But that's not the point. We wanted him to be still be able to learn why he's at home.
Mm-hmm.
He's at home, he's playing games, watching TV.
Right.
You know, while other kids are learning. We need things to have at home. Never got that until I had to, like, actually force it, you know, have someone go up there, say, give me the stuff, you know. So.
Okay. All right. Well, hey, look, I can go on and on. This is a problem that exists. We got folks who are running for office right now at this point in time. And those are the kinds of questions you need to ask these folks. What are they doing about these problems here? That's the major thing. That's one of the major problems. The funding sources for an organization like this, if you will, making sure they got enough funds to be able to respond to a mom and her son aspect of it. But again, at the same time, it goes to the other level too, at the school district. Are they being responsible enough to do the problem? Otherwise, you wouldn't exist if they were doing the job, right?
Right.
Okay?
Right.
Now, you've got to understand, you got a celebration here, April 26, 2014, 5 to 9 p.m. Talk about that real quick, like, and where's it going to be?
I got a real quick It's going to be at Mount Tabor Space. At 54441 Southeast Belmont Street, and it's our 5th year celebration, and we're gonna have free food, entertainment.
But what are they gonna learn there? What are they gonna learn?
We're gonna have a couple of the families up speaking about some of the stuff we talked about today. We'll have a couple of our partners come up and talk how we're gonna partnership.
I understand you got one partner right there, right? You're gonna be there.
Yeah, that's
one of our
independent skills trainers.
Come on in real quick.
/DJ/DJ.
Okay.
He does it all. Like all of us.
Okay. You got one more guy. Is in there? He's still out there.
Yeah, Tyler. He's part of our board.
Okay, come on, Tyler, real quick. Come on over here and put your face in there. We're getting ready to cut it off real quick, like. Come on in here, Tyler, real quick, like. Come on over here real quick. Just stick your face up in there and hit. There's the team, folks. There's the team. There they are. And again, it's going to be a 5th annual celebration, April 26th, at Tabor Space, 5441 Southeast Belmont Street. Okay. And that's going to be all day? And it's free to the public.
Free for the public. And the phone number, the office number is 503-381-0804 for more information.
Okay, cool. Bottom line, they get all this information, how to get their kids involved to respond to some of the issues that you're talking about right here, right?
Right.
Nate? Right?
Sounds good.
That's a good deal.
And it's free to the public, but also we also looking for donations so to give everybody an opportunity to see what we're doing, talk about what we're doing, but also those who have the heart can dig deep and help us out.
The heart to help Mike.
Adopt
a family.
That's right.
That's your new slogan now. Adopt a family. That's the key, okay, to get it done. Right, Nate?
Right.
That's working on. Folks, thank you very, very much. Appreciate you being here.
Right. Thank
and
you.
Hopefully this will be successful. And that's, like I said, those folks who are running for office, that's what they need to be responding to.
Right.
Thanks very much, okay? Right. Folks, thank voters, you. Hey, take care. Do vote. Get out there and vote. See you next week, i.e. when you meet some more candidates. Take care and have a good one. Happy Easter.